anticipation on board mats as the supersonic jet taxis to the runway. In the control tower, Gilles Rochelin clears Air France flight 4590 for takeoff on runway 26 right. It's 4:40 in the afternoon. So far, for passengers and crew, everything is normal. Captain Marty lines up the plane at the start of the runway, ready to release the power of Concorde's four Rolls-Royce engines. For senior pilot John Hutchinson, a moment like this is always special.
As you open the throttles up to full power, you feel this huge surge of power in the small of your back as the airplane accelerates down the runway, and you just get the feeling that the one thing the airplane wants to do at that point is to get into the air as quickly as possible, into its natural environment.
In the control tower, Gilles Rochelin monitors the takeoff.
I was watching the Concorde gaining a power on the runway because it was so nice to see that. It's a very heavy plane, so you know that the beginning is quite slow, then you gain the speed.
Concorde accelerates down the 4,000 meter runway. It passes through 320 kilometers per hour. Using computer graphics, we recreate what happens next. For Gilles Rochelin, it's a moment of sheer horror.
Suddenly, I saw a flame just behind the body of the aircraft. So I jumped on my mic to say, "Airframe 4590, you have flames behind you."
Captain Marty cannot see the flames, but accelerating through 328 kilometers per hour, Concorde is committed to the takeoff. There are only 2,000 meters of runway left, but Concorde needs 3,000 meters to have any chance of stopping safely.
After this speed, whatever is the situation, the plane has to take off. It could not abort the takeoff. And as I was watching the flames, I saw the nose of the Concorde lifting up.
At 4:43 and 15 seconds, Captain Marty pulls on the control stick. Concorde takes to the air. This is how Concorde flight AF4590 appears to witnesses. Martine Bornet works in an office on the western edge of the airport. At 4:44, she sees a terrifying sight.
I was looking out of my window and I saw Concorde taking off very slowly with the back of the plane on fire. I was really afraid. Because of the flames, I was convinced that the plane was going to explode right here in front of the office.
The stricken airliner flies directly overhead. Close by where Martin works, courier Emmanuel Vermignon is driving his van past the end of the runway.
When Concorde went over, I had the window open and I was wearing a polo shirt. And I can tell you that the heat the plane was belching out melted parts of my shirt and gave me little blisters. I could really feel the heat on the ground.
While Captain Marty struggles with the controls to gain altitude, out of his vision, flames engulf the left wing. The sickening sight is caught on camera by the wife of a truck driver. It is the only video footage ever captured showing Concorde on fire. It'll prove to be a vital link in the investigation. Supersonic Concorde has just taken off.
plane's half.
I was in my office talking to an agency. The window faces the runway, and I was interrupted by an incredible noise. It was Concorde. It was on fire, and it was listing violently.
Concorde lurches to the left. The plane stalls and plunges to the ground. It's 4:45. It's the moment every air traffic controller dreads. Gilles Rogelin reaches for his mic.
I've called Air France, and I said, Air France 4590, do you hear me?
Air France 4590, me recevez-vous?
I said it twice.
Air France 4590, me recevez-vous?
There was no answer.
A supersonic jet, loaded with fuel and 109 people on board, crashes right on top of a hotel on the outskirts of Gonesse. A terrifying fireball tears through the building. British teacher Alice Brooking has just checked into a first floor room.
So I went straight for the door of the room that I was in. Saw there was no way out via the stairs. I leapt across the room, leapt across the bed to the window. Saw, luckily, that the receptionist was already down in the car park underneath me, and he just said, you have to jump.
At the same time, Christine Turpin also witnesses the explosion and fears the worst.
It fell. And from where I was, I thought it had landed on the gas station. And I thought, because my daughter and the girl who worked for me were there, that they were all dead.
As Christine Turpin drives in, a passenger armrest falls onto the petrol station. It's a chilling reminder for Christine of the fate of the passengers.
When you saw the armrest, you couldn't help but imagine what it must have been like for the people on board the plane.
Within 8 minutes of the crash, dozens of fire engines and ambulances race to the scene. An appalling tragedy, not just for those on Concorde, but for those in the hotel. Regional Fire Chief Colonel Fabrice Chauvin leads the rescue.
Whilst driving, there were many things going through my mind. The important thing for me was to divide the operation into two separate parts. One, the aircraft crash, extinguishing the fire and the rescue of any survivors. And two, organizing treatment for the wounded before they're evacuated to hospital.
The intensity of the fire is so great that it'll take 3 hours to bring it under control. As these TV news images show, the charred remains of the airliner and the hotel are unrecognizable. The rescue attempts are futile. 113 people die, 4 from the hotel and 109 passengers and crew in Concorde. Of the Ike family are wiped out. The children's grandparents had wanted to treat the family to a holiday of a lifetime and had booked the Concorde flight. School teachers Klaus and Margaret Frensen had saved for 20 years to fly on Concorde. Rescuers begin the group
gruesome task of pulling the bodies from the crash site. One of the hotel workers to die is a 19-year-old student, Kenza Rashid. She joined the staff of the Hotelissimo only the day before the crash to earn some holiday money. Another victim is chambermaid Devrani Chundang Singh. She dies leaving behind her two children. Most of the bodies are burned beyond recognition, and the forensic pathologists can only identify victims by their dental records. It's a harrowing time for the victims' relatives, like Jörg Meyer.
One of the more difficult things was the identification of my father and his partner. One has to say, nothing much remains of the passengers after an air crash. That was difficult.
Jörg will have to wait 2 weeks before pathologists identify the remains of his father.
That's how long we had to wait. You can imagine that that's not exactly easy, day after day.
The crash takes everyone by surprise. Concorde, the queen of the skies. The plane that makes supersonic travel a reality. People's dreams come true. Had never had a fatal accident. Until this moment. It takes just 120 seconds to shatter that perfect record. Now, by rewinding the events of that fateful day, and by going deep into the investigation, we can reveal what really happened. Cutting-edge computer simulation will take us where no camera can go, into the heart of the disaster zone. Send their top investigators. Using their data, we can now piece together the deadly chain of events to find out what really caused this terrible tragedy. As the investigation begins, nothing is off limits. Did pilot Captain Marty make a fatal error, or was there a fault hidden within the perfect plane? Investigators make routine checks of the passenger and luggage lists. Immediately, they find something suspicious. 19 pieces of luggage that, according to the loading report, should not have been on the plane. They don't belong to the passengers on flight AF4590. Could a terrorist have smuggled a bomb onto the plane? It wouldn't be the first time. 270 people died in 1988 when terrorists planted a bomb in the luggage that destroyed a Pan Am 747 in the infamous Lockerbie incident. At Gonesse, investigators divide the Concorde crash site into a grid in order to make a meticulous search. They photograph and tag everything found in each section. It's a painstaking process, which takes 4 weeks. Then, every bit of wreckage is taken away for identification and analysis. Three hangars at Le Bourget, another Paris airport, become their final resting place. This pile of debris is all that remains of the hotel. Such is the intensity of the crash and fire that a 40-room building is reduced to little more than a pile of rubble. This is what remains of Concorde. One of the world's finest examples of modern engineering is now just a tangled heap of charred rubber, aluminium, melted plastic, and fractured hydraulics. The French investigators separate and identify every fragment. Among these burned remains lie the crucial clues to the cause of Concorde's crash. Within hours, the French Bureau of Air Accidents team recover the black boxes. These devices are carried on all airliners to record important technical data and crucial crucially, the pilot's conversation from the cockpit. They analyze the black boxes. They hear no sound of an explosion. It's clear to them, terrorism is not to blame. The investigators are forced to look for a new lead. They focus on the last-minute engine repair Captain Marty orders just before takeoff. They know Concorde returned from New York the previous day with a faulty thrust reverser on engine number 2. Thrust reversers help to slow the planes down after they've landed. Investigators analyze the flight data recorder closely, but find no evidence that a faulty thrust reverser could cause the accident. The pressure to find an answer increases. Until they do, the French authorities ground all Air France Concorde flights. The spotlight is now on the 120 seconds from the start of Concorde's final takeoff. Captain John Hutchinson has flown hundreds of Concorde takeoffs.
Once you've lined up on the runway, the captain will then punch on the stopwatch and open the throttles fully. The captain's job is to keep straight down the runway. The co-pilot's job is to do the speed calls. And the flight engineer is sitting there and he's monitoring all the instruments, in particular this bank of instruments here, which are the engine instruments.
Data from the black boxes makes it clear that everything is normal until Concorde reaches 323 kilometers per hour. Concorde is now only 79 seconds from disaster. Data recorders reveal a sudden loss of power in both engines under the left wing. Immediately, the black box picks up the dramatic warning from the control tower.
Air France 4590, you have flames behind you.
Despite the warning, pilot Christian Marty has passed the point of no return. There's not enough tarmac to stop safely. He has to take off.
He pulled back on the control column to rotate the airplane up to its nose up. Angle of 12.9 degrees, and he was having problems with the left-hand engines, not producing the power they should have, and he had been working very hard trying to control the airplane, trying to get speed, but of course he was being overwhelmed by these problems on the left-hand engines.
The engines become the new focus of the investigation. Why did they lose power at such a critical time? Just 2 minutes into its journey, Air France Concorde flight AF4590 crashes, killing 113 people. A devastating blow to the world's first supersonic airliner. Using advanced computer graphics based on the official report, we go deep into the investigation to unravel the deadly chain of events. Investigators know that two left engines lose power as Concorde passes 323 kilometers per hour on the runway. But why? Then, an important new clue. The French investigators find several fragments of tire on the runway. One of them weighs 4.5 kilograms. Tests quickly confirm they belong to Concorde. It's a significant lead. Why? Because Concorde's tires inflate to extremely high pressures, which make them more likely to burst than other aircraft, especially during takeoff and landing. Pilot John Hutchinson explains.
And in fact, when the captain pulls back to rotate, he's actually compressing the undercarriage into the runway, so there's even more stress on the tires and the wheels at that particular point.
This additional pressure makes Concorde's tires even more vulnerable. Now they're onto something. The French accident investigators go back through the records and discover that for Concorde, tire blowouts are far from rare. They identify over 50 cases of tire burst on takeoff and landing over 24 years. Incidents involved another Air France Concorde, this time at Washington's Dulles Airport in 1979. Bill Lightfoot was a passenger on Concorde that day.
I could see a big ragged hole in the wing with like pieces of aluminum or a metallic alloy and a lot of liquid pouring out of that of the hole that had been ripped in the wing.
The official report into this accident found that the tire burst during taxiing. Then the exposed metal wheel got very hot and exploded just before takeoff. The plane took off, but 20 minutes later returned safely to the ground. The plane survived this scare, but it caused a major overhaul of tire safety. Concorde engineers installed sensors to detect underinflated tires, modified inspection procedures for wheels before every flight, and most importantly, as aviation expert David Learmont explains, developed stronger tires that can carry twice their normal load.
The requirement was that in test flights, you should be able to have a complete tire blowout during the takeoff run, and that you should be able to complete the takeoff with no tires left. And that is what the wheels subsequently were, and never again did a wheel fail.
That is, until 18 years later in Paris, when something goes very wrong. Despite all the safety measures, one of Concorde's tires explodes in fragments. Investigators dig deeper. They re-examine all the debris found on the runway and then make the most important discovery of the investigation. This 43-centimeter mystery strip of metal. When you match the 43-centimeter strip of metal to the damage on Concorde's tire, it's a perfect fit. Suddenly, the whole inquiry now depends on the source of this metal. Where did it come from? It takes 5 weeks of painstaking detective work, comparing it to the thousands of parts that make up aircraft. Then, a breakthrough. They discover the metal strip comes from the engine mounting of a DC-10. The flight log from Paris reveals a Continental Airlines DC-10 took off 5 minutes before Concorde. They track down the plane to Houston, Texas, and incredibly find the engine has a missing part. It's the metal strip, fitted 16 days earlier during maintenance on the DC-10. When David Learmont first sees the photographs of the strip of metal, he's astonished.
It had really rough edges, and this is not just rough edges because Concorde had run over it. It had been cut roughly. The edges were not straight, not even when it was made. The other thing is that it had holes drilled in it for putting screws or rivets through, and these were all over the place.
Investigators now have a very strong theory about how the strip of metal contributed to the crash. 81 seconds before the crash, Concorde AF4590 is traveling at 323 kilometers per hour down the runway. The tire hits the metal strip. The tire explodes, and a massive 4.5 kilogram chunk of rubber from the tire flies at high speed up into the wing. But Concorde's fuel tanks are in the wings, and the delta-shaped wing is not designed to withstand such an impact.
This sort of eventuality had never been foreseen in trials. It was estimated in all the trials for certificating the aircraft in the first place that if a tyre exploded, the pieces of tyre that would actually come away from the wheel would be about 1 kilogram in weight.
The chunk of rubber that hits Concorde's wing that day weighs nearly 5 times as much, 4.5 kilograms. No one had planned for that sort of impact. What's more, you can match the large rubber fragment of the tire with a dent on the wing. But surprisingly, the wing is not punctured at that point. So, if the heavy chunk of rubber hadn't punctured the wing, what made the fuel leak out?
The piece of tar which actually hit the wing and did the damage was so big and so flat that although it was so heavy, it didn't go through the wing at all. And it caused such a shockwave to go through the fuel that it actually blew a plug of wing tank skin outwards. The shock was that bad.
The wing, it sets off a pressure wave which finds the weakest joint in the fuel tank. The fuel bursts out of the tank. 75 liters of fuel pour into the engine every second. But even fuel gushing over the engine needs a spark to ignite. Where did the spark come from? Crashes after takeoff from Paris Charles de Gaulle Airport. Our graphics can simulate a virtual camera on the runway to reveal the cause of the accident. As the plane hurtles down the runway, a rogue strip of metal bursts a tire. 81 seconds before the crash, a heavy chunk of rubber flies into the fuel tanks. Fuel cascades over the engines. Not enough on its own to cause a catastrophe, it needs a spark.
options.